G'day, I'm Tim Thompson. A few weeks ago, I visited Michael Pettinella and had a look at the dam and wetlands he was putting in for sustainable water harvesting. And it turns out that there is so much more to the story of this farm. When I got talking to Michael, I realised that at every layer of their business, they are practising and promoting not only sustainability, but really smart business. Today, we're going to talk to Michael and his family about all of the initiatives that they're bringing into place to work smarter, to compete in modern intensive horticulture production, and to do it sustainably. Michael, how are you, mate?
Good, Tim.
Mate, thank you so much for having us back on the farm. It's an absolute pleasure to be here, and I'm so excited by all of the things that you're doing.
Nice introduction.
We're standing at the moment in a paddock of strawberries.
Off-season, winter.
Off-season, we've got to put that in, yeah. So they're not looking spectacular, are they? But this is an industry that is potentially one that would lead to erosion, would use a lot of chemicals, would have a tremendous impact on the environment, and eventually cost you money because you've got to fix up the problems that that causes. You're actually doing a lot of things out here in the paddock to grow your fruit more sustainably.
To a degree. We started with sustainability 20 years ago. One of the first things it was to avoid up and down the hill. So we've done a whole farm plan with Mark Hicksman, who's with the government. And the advice was to have a gradient of 2 degrees to slow the water runoff from the rows.
Now that's all very well, but right here you've got a gradient of 7 degrees, and tradition says that you should plant your crops north-south so that you get even sunlight. Mm. So how did you get around that?
The good old thing, compromise. We compromise on the angle. So we agreed to this angle. Too slight an angle, water doesn't run out of the rows. We want the water to run out, to walk out, not run out, to slow the water runoff. And being plastic, and so much plastic, 2 mils of rain has a lot of runoff.
Because with this system, you're right, half your paddock is hard plastic, and so you're going to get tremendous runoff. It's like, you know, having a road, isn't it? So what you've done is, instead of planting your rows up and down the hill, you've planted them across at exactly the right angle to get the speed of runoff that you want, so that you can capture as much water into the ground. Is that correct?
And the slow down of the sediment. And that's why we put grasses. We put a rye grass, a very slow one, to hold the soil. Between that and the headlands dome, we try to control the water where it runs. And we've been doing this for a number of years, and each year we implement a little bit more.
So here, Michael, we've got a really gently radius track. It's not the classic corner that you would expect to see. And the purpose for that is that you're actually using this track as a contour bank, is that correct?
Yeah.
So not only are your crops planted in such a way that you get a 3 degree slope rather than a 7, but you're also using your tracks to shape and move the water across the environment.
Yep.
Yeah. People don't often think of the built environment as being part of your whole farm, but in this case, the track is actually interacting with the crops that you grow.
Yeah. And also, having the correct shape and the crowning of it is very important. With the tractor and grader blade, you make it level, you don't really maintain it properly. So we have gone to the expense of putting better tracks, bit of access, and the controls of water without making, by putting a good material on, there's no cut, no soil cut.
You're also doing a lot of really intelligent things with your cover crops.
Yep, we run the biofumigants. I remember reading years ago how the leaf is a factory, a manufacturer. The same as the farm.
Yeah.
So certain green crops are for organic matter, and certain green crops are to sterilise the soil. So we've gone to cropping radishes, mustard, and BQ mulch.
Because you have a lot of trouble with root rot.
Yes.
In strawberries. So rather than relying solely on chemicals for that, you're trying to use a natural plant to control that. So Michael's approach towards healthy, sustainable growing soils is to keep the photosynthetic area maximized and to keep his bare ground covered with growth at all times. He's not only holding the soil in place, but he's pouring all of that carbon into the soil that's there waiting, ready for his next crop. The family's also utilizing areas that are not viable for cropping by planting out a vast array of native species. From grasses through bushes right up to trees, they're hoping to encourage a lot more native insects and other animals onto the farm to help increase biodiversity and control some of the pest populations that they would otherwise have to use chemicals on. There's not a spare spot on this farm that isn't managed with a view to productivity and biodiversity. So Michael, not only are we doing amazing things on the farm, but you guys are doing some pretty amazing things in your packaging shed now. Yourself and a few of your brothers.
Yeah.
I believe John's bringing in some new innovations in packaging.
And spending our money.
Spending your money. John, how are you, mate?
Welcome to Fresh Berry, Tim.
Thank you, mate.
Good.
Thank you, mate. I am fascinated by fruit packaging and production because it's just such a complex business, and you guys have been playing around in the packaging space now for a little while.
We have, Tim. 6 years ago we decided that going forward we have to be more environmentally conscious.
Yep.
With our packaging, we have to look for different types of packaging, and we started looking around the world basically.
Yeah, right.
The compostability, the plastics, how we do all our usage,
yep.
Our cardboard waste, our produce waste. So, no, it's been a long process, you know what I mean?
And the jury's sort of out a bit, isn't it? There's a lot of debate in this space. People believe that plastic packaging's better because it can be fully recycled, at least the PET stuff.
Correct.
But then there are other people that say, well, hang on, it's not getting recycled.
That's right.
So maybe it's better to use a cardboard or something like that.
Look,
and you're sort of stuck in the middle as a grower, aren't you? How do you deal with that?
Look, it's hard at the moment because the change is a problem.
Yep.
Some are saying plastic and
yep.
PET and so forth, but that's a hard process because how much of the consumer does recycle? And that's an issue.
It's a question that I don't think anyone has the answer to that I've been able to speak to.
And to me, personally, I like the compostable punnet.
Yeah.
Packaging tubs or punnets, we call them, because the consumer can take them home, put them in the back garden, have a little veggie patch, and there's no compostable. Oh, it's compostable.
So they are a single-use product, but they're a single-use product from a certified forest.
Correct, which is important.
That goes back to soil health and soil carbon.
That's it. And that's very important for the whole process.
Well, I'm really keen to see the innovations that you guys are putting into this shed. Can we go and have a look?
Quite welcome, Tim.
Come on, let's go and have a look. Into Pandora's Cave.
That's it.
So this is the heart of your operation, mate.
This is our engine room.
Yep. So John, these are the older lines. This is your existing packaging line that you've run with for a number of years.
That's correct, Tim. We've upgraded it now. To be more efficient and to also to make it easier for our employees. Before there was a lot of bending and picking up.
Yes.
Now you notice. Just pack the fruit.
Everything's at waste level.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah. But you're still intensively packaging by hand.
That's correct.
And you're moving away from that. You're still employing staff, but you're working in a more efficient way to put through more fruit.
And yes, we are. Look, and the staff is very important to us. A lot of our staff, some of our staff members have been here for 40 years plus.
Yeah, right.
We're very proud of that. And all our staff members, to us, is family. So we have to look after them. In turn, they look after us.
And so you bought them brand new machines?
All new brand new machines.
Let's go and have a look.
The machines that they use to pack the fruit are pretty innovative. They've got to be flexible enough to be able to serve a number of different major retailers plus small independents with a range of packaging to suit their individual customer and market demands. Not everyone wants cardboard, not everyone wants clamshell plastic. Not only that, but they've also got to be prepared for future trends and changes in packaging so that they don't have to replace their packaging line every time something new comes out. This is quite an effort. Not only that, but they're also looking at efficiencies for their staff and OH&S so that there's not too much bending and travelling throughout the course of the day doing your job. I was lucky enough to catch up with Daniel, the production manager, to talk to him about how his new machinery was going to solve some of the problems of efficiency and how it all worked together.
So the way the machine is set up at the moment, we can do tomatoes and blueberries. We can do plastic clamshell, plastic top seal, cardboard top seal trays. So from over there, the big yellow cage over on my left, we bring in the bulk bins of product. That's lifted into a hopper, which then travels up the blue lifting belt and travels down the inspection belt, where we'll have girls on there removing out of spec product. That will then travel into the hoppers. Then each hopper individually weighs the set amount depending on the product we're running for that day, whether it be 250 gram, 500 gram. Then once the hoppers recognise the correct weight, it will drop into the punnets, and then they'll travel down the line through the top seal machine, or if they're clamshell, they'll travel through the check weigh machine.
Yeah, pro seal gear is quite good. It's quite versatile.
Oh, very good. All right, well, let's go and have a chat to Gianni, who I believe is involved in a little bit of marketing, because people think that, you know, packaging's static. It's not, and packaging is a huge part of marketing your product, isn't it?
We'll move over and talk to Gianni.
Good day, Gianni, how are you, mate?
Good, Tim, how are you going?
Not too bad. Now, you're involved in marketing this product. You've got many years of experience in that, and choice of packaging is critical.
100%, Tim. Yeah. Over the years, I've seen packaging change a lot.
Gianni then took me for a trip down memory lane, looking at some of the old wooden, plastic, and finally cardboard punnets that used to be around when I was a kid. And it's quite remarkable when you look at all of the packaging close up, side by side, just how many times we've changed the way we package fruit over the last 20 or 30 years. Gianni, you've got a fantastic range of packaging here, and it's brought back a lot of nostalgia for me, and I suppose it reinforces the point that packaging is always changing in the market, isn't it? And you've got to be ahead of the curve.
Yeah, so Tim, we're in a transition period at the moment. We've gone into the top seal plastic ones, as you can see here, and we're trying to transition into our fully compostable Australian certified punnets, home compostable. A lot of the supermarkets at the moment are making claims to switch over by 2025 for all fully recyclable or compostable punnets, and we just want to be ahead of the curve so we're prepared for when that time comes.
So there's a lot of talk at the moment, Gianni, about recycling, but really it's the customer that dictates what's taken up and what's not, and you've got to remain flexible.
Yeah, Tim, at the moment we have to be a bit more flexible. At the end of the day, the customer dictates the market. We're just going to make sure we're catering for their requirements, and that's why, you know, we're doing the plastic top seal, and we're obviously doing the 350 compostable ones for the moment.
Growing fruit certainly might seem simple, but I tell you what, it's a complex task, and it's an amazing family that's brought together a farm like this. Guys, it's been wonderful meeting you, and it's lovely to see a family and employees that are almost like family working together in the agricultural space, building such a sustainable and forward-thinking business. And it's been an absolute privilege to spend some time with you today, and I'd just really like to thank you for making yourself so available and putting yourselves out there and showing what can be done.
Thank you. It's been a pleasure.
And all the best for all your future endeavours.
Thanks very much.
And when this train line's finished, I want to ride.
Okay. All right. Oh, here we go.